In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, just give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Just give me Jesus. Come to die, oh, when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, just give me Jesus, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. Just give me Jesus.
Good morning. Welcome to the Real Tree Church. We're excited that you're here to worship with us today. I'd like to direct your attention to the bulletins and the announcements that are in the bulletins. In particular, the summer Bible study, Why We Pray, will be meeting this Wednesday at 6:30. This is going to be a long segment if I keep doing this. Also want to draw your attention to the nursery attendants that are needed. It's an important ministry within our church, primarily serving children 1 to 3 years of age after the music is over during the worship time. So talk to Becky if you want to be involved with that. Psalm 106 today. To properly understand this text, we have to look at the previous text. We look at 105, which rehearsed God's goodness to Abraham's descendants through the Exodus story and Moses' leadership. The plagues were referenced, parting of the sea. It brought the hearers to an appropriate response of worship and praise. As we come into Psalm 106, we have this thematic break thrown on, and we do this dramatic U-turn very emotional U-turn as we read through it. Psalm 105 consisted of 45 verses that focused on the fidelity of God through his presence, protection, and providence of his people. Psalm 106, on the other hand, highlights the other side of the coin. Namely, we'll read 48 verses that details Israel's failings and what the Old Testament describes as a stiff-necked rebellion to God during the same time frame of the Exodus and beyond. The placement of this reminder should motivate us to reflect on the absolute tenacity of our rebellion towards God. The goal of our scripture reading should always be to connect text with other biblical texts to anchor and expand our understanding. This psalm shares a lot of its tone with other Old Testament texts, especially Nehemiah chapter 9, where the Jews are returning from exile and Nehemiah confesses the people's sins. Isaiah 63, where the Lord's mercy is recounted and remembered, we see a reflection of that in this psalm. And especially Daniel 9, where the prophet is praying for the people that are in exile. The beginning and the conclusion are also shared in 1 Chronicles 16. The psalmist looked for us in their meditation on the acts of God and what they reflect about him. So too should be our reading as we listen to this text today. I'll read through the entire chapter today so we hear the full impact of its story. So please join me as we read Psalm 106. Praise the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Who can utter the mighty deeds of the Lord or declare all his praise? Blessed are they who observe justice, who do righteousness at all times. Remember me, O Lord, when you show favor to your people. Help me when you save them, that I may look upon the prosperity of your chosen ones, that I may rejoice in the gladness of your nation, that I may glory with your inheritance. Both we and our fathers have sinned. We have committed iniquities. We have done wickedness. Our fathers, when they were in Egypt, did not consider your wondrous works. They did not remember the abundance of your steadfast love, but rebelled by the sea at the Red Sea. Yet he saved them for his name's sake, that he might make known his mighty power. He rebuked the Red Sea, and it became dry, and he led them through the deep as through a desert. So he saved them from the hand of the foe and redeemed them from the power of the enemy. And the waters covered their adversaries. Not one of them was left. Then they believed his words, they sang his praise. But they soon forgot his works. They did not wait for his counsel. But they had a wanton craving in the wilderness and put God to the test in the desert. He gave them what they asked, but sent a wasting disease among them. When men in the camp were jealous of Moses and Aaron, the Holy One of the Lord, the earth opened and swallowed up Dathan and covered the company of Abiram. Fire also broke out in their company. The flame burned up the wicked. They made a calf in Horeb and worshipped a metal image. They exchanged the glory of God for the image of an ox that eats grass. They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt, wondrous works in the land of Ham, and awesome deeds by the Red Sea. Therefore, he said he would destroy them. Had not Moses, his chosen one, stood in the breach before him to turn away his wrath from destroying them? Then they despised the pleasant land, having no faith in his promise. They murmured in their tents and did not obey the voice of the Lord. Therefore he raised his hand and swore to them that he would make them fall in the wilderness, and would make their offspring fall among the nations, scattering them among the lands. Then they yoked themselves to the Baal of Peor and ate sacrifices offered to the dead. They provoked the Lord to anger with their deeds, and a plague broke out among them. Then Phinehas stood up and intervened, and the plague was stayed. and that was counted to him as righteousness from generation to generation forever. They angered him at the waters of Meribah, and it went ill with Moses on their account. For they made his spirit bitter, and he spoke rashly with his lips. They did not destroy the peoples as the Lord commanded them, but they mixed with the nations and learned to do as they did. They served their idols, which became a snare to them. They sacrificed their sons and their daughters to the demons. They poured out innocent blood, the blood of their sons and daughters, whom they sacrificed to the idols of Canaan, and the land was polluted with blood. Thus they became unclean by their acts and played the whore in their deeds. Then the anger of the Lord was kindled against his people, and he abhorred his heritage. He gave them into the hand of the nations, so that those who hated them ruled over them. Their enemies oppressed them, and they were brought into subjection under their power. Many times he delivered them, but they were rebellious in their purposes and were brought low through their iniquity. Nevertheless, he looked upon their distress when he heard their cry. For their sake he remembered his covenant and relented according to the abundance of his steadfast love. He caused them to be pitied by all those who held him captive. Save us, O Lord our God, and gather us from among the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Let all the people say, Amen. Praise the Lord. Please join me in prayer. We praise you, O God, with words of thanksgiving in our mouths and in our hearts, words which can never really do justice to the depth of your love for us, given our fallen and twisted nature and absolute rebellion against your sovereignty. We rejoice in your blessing, yet we so often fail to live up to them. Like your people of old, we often desire to fashion you in our image or in ways that we can control. Knowing these failings of ours as you do, you still adopt us into a life of grace and abundant love, being united with Jesus Christ through the power of your Spirit. We do not deserve such gifts. We can only receive them and respond because your Holy Spirit intercedes for us in our weakness. Yet as the psalmist directed, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his steadfast love endures forever. May this time of worship, the taking of communion, and our daily living proclaim our thanksgiving for these undeserved and lavish gifts of grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and worship our great God.
Heard an old story, how Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won a victory. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory. About his healing. Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was saved. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling
don't you have a seat? I'm going to have the ushers come forward, and we'll take the offering during this next song.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe. We believe in this broken generation. When all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit when He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection when He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe. Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. Let the lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. Let love invade, let the church live loud. And God will save. We believe. We believe. We believe in Him. Over the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know Your love will never fail. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. We believe.
Father, we do believe. God, we praise You this morning and give You the glory, God, and ask that You would open our hearts and minds now to Your truth as we continue to worship You through the preaching of the Word. Lord, may I be clear in the people here. Lord, we praise You and give You the glory in all things and pray that Your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't you take a second and greet somebody. Say howdy to your neighbor. Well, good morning. Welcome again, everyone. I'm glad to see you're enjoying our little short fellowship time there. And I did have Vern turn on the air conditioning, off the air conditioning, so don't get nervous. It should be about 80 in here in a few minutes.
Only in your mind,
Rob. It's close as hell as I'm going to get. Well, welcome to all of you again. I'm thankful that the Lord has brought you here to hear from His Word, and that's what we're going to do. As always, we're going to dig right in. So this morning we'll be continuing our study of Matthew's Gospel, so I invite you to take your Bibles in hand and turn with me over to Matthew chapter 16. As we begin chapter 16 this morning, we're going to consider the first four verses. Chapter 16, verses 1 through 4. In our text last week, we read of our Lord healing a multitude of people, and then again feeding that great multitude. And we need to keep in mind as we read over these things, as we work our way through Matthew, the overall theme or the point of Matthew's gospel. Why did he write it? He wrote it to prove to us that Jesus of Nazareth is God, is the Messiah, and is King, and that he is that for all people, not just the Jews. And Matthew made that clear in the text last week. Jesus was again doing things that only God can do in healing. Every form of disease up to and including replacing limbs, perhaps. And again, feeding thousands of people with just a few loaves of bread and a few fish. These are things that only God can do. No matter how liberal theologians have tried to explain it away, and believe me, they have, the fact of the matter is Jesus did things that only God could do. He is indeed divine. He is indeed fully man and fully God. He is indeed the God-man. Matthew records two separate and different accounts of our Lord feeding multitudes because he fed two ethnically different groups of people. The first group was largely Jewish, and the second largely Gentile. God offers salvation to all people through the Lord Jesus Christ, both Jew and Gentile. In our account last week, I hope you were also able to see the character of our Lord, the character of God, that of compassion and giving. He's compassionate and giving. We serve a compassionate and giving God. Amen. He cares for our serious needs as well as our simple needs. He is a compassionate and caring God who gives us what we need when we need it and keeps things from us that we don't need, that we perhaps think we do. So we need to follow that example. We too are to be compassionate and giving. I pray that you've taken some time this week to ponder on those things. Are you as compassionate and giving as you should be? I know that I certainly have some work to do in those areas. And I pray that the Lord will continue to form us into the image of our compassionate and giving Savior. This week in our text, our Lord comes face to face again with the major opposition to Him. And although our passage is relatively short as far as narratives are concerned, I think there are some important biblical principles we can garner from it. So let's go now to our text. I invite you to stand with me in reverence for the reading of the Word of the Living God, Matthew chapter 16, verses 1 through 4. Matthew records for us, "And the Pharisees and Sadducees came, and to test him, they asked him to show them a sign from heaven. He answered them, 'When it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be stormy today, for the sky is red and threatening. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it, except the sign of Jonah.' So he left them and departed." This is the word of the living God. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning again in worship as we dig into another passage of Scripture. Father, help us to see what you have in it for us. God, help us to know you more, to grow in our faith deeper all the time, to love each other more, to love you more. And Father, as always, if there are those who are here or are listening online who don't know you, we plead for their souls this morning. We ask that you would save them, that you would draw them to yourself, Lord. We thank you for your blessings. your continued provision for us as a church and individually. We pray that your will would be done in our lives personally as well as the life of this church corporately. We give you glory in all things in Jesus' name. Amen. You can have a seat. You maybe wouldn't think so, but in our world today, there are many who still seek after signs. People want to know the future, and they will go to great and ridiculous lengths to try to find it out. Now, on the reality side of things, there are some who are excellent at forecasting the future in things such as the stock market or real estate or the future of the dollar and things of that nature. However, many people want to know what is going to happen to them personally in the future. And they will do, and they'll also do some pretty crazy things thinking that somehow they're going to find out what the future of their life entails. There are still many who believe in astrology. These people get up every day and check their horoscopes to see what the stars can tell them about their future. I've always thought that astrology and reading your horoscope was goofy, to say the least, but there are many today who truly believe in it. As a matter of fact, a recent study reported that 45% of university students believe that there was something to astrology. 45%. And worse yet, when students of hard science were interviewed, that number dropped only slightly to 37%. Horoscopes. Others seek to have their fortune told through palm reading, tarot cards, psychics, and even the magic eight ball. People are seeking after signs and ways to tell what is going to happen in the future. And most of those same people who will consult all of these ridiculous methods are quick to dismiss and even ridicule the Bible. And it's only through the Bible that we can know for certain what our future holds. Most seek after the false and reject the genuine. The same was true in our Lord's day. Those who should have known best and immediately recognized who and what Jesus was could not see the forest for the trees. They couldn't see him. They couldn't see the sign standing before them. Even though they were supposed experts in Scripture, they missed the greatest sign of all that was sent by God, his only begotten Son, as he stood in front of them doing things that only God could do. They couldn't see it. Let's go back now to the text and see what the Lord has in it for us. Take a look at verse 1. And the Pharisees and Sadducees came, and to test him, they asked him to show them a sign from heaven. So think of this. Our Lord has been, for the last couple weeks in our message, in our text, has been in Gentile country. And now he no sooner gets back to Jewish territory, and here come these Jewish leaders again to get after him. Here they come. And right away, an astute student of Scripture will recognize that this sounds very familiar, doesn't it, to something that we have already studied. Perhaps back in chapter 12, hint, hint. Back in chapter 12, verse 38 and following, a group of Jewish leaders asked a very similar question. But there was one major difference. In our text today, Matthew records the group in chapter 12 as being scribes and Pharisees, but notice here in this passage that this group questioning our Lord is made up of Pharisees and Sadducees. So you had scribes and Pharisees, but now you have Pharisees and Sadducees. This is significant to note because these two groups or sects of within Judaism do not get along. They don't like each other. Their theology doesn't match up. The Pharisees, as we have discussed before, were the conservatives. They were the conservative group. They were largely made up of blue-collar type men who were serious about the things of God. Sadducees, on the other hand, could be explained as being liberals. They did not hold to all of Scripture as being the Word of God. They did not believe in anything supernatural. They didn't believe in angels, demons, or even the resurrection or life after death. You see, the Sadducees' primary concern was for the here and now. They were mostly aristocratic, being very wealthy. They held high social statuses, and they were largely concerned with keeping that wealth and status. They were interested in having their best life now. It would have been as if Dr. John MacArthur and Joel Osteen came together to work against something. That's how odd this should seem to you, if you know who those two fellows are, and I hope you know at least one of them. Hope you know Dr. MacArthur. Can you see how shocking that would be? That's what's taking place here. The liberals and the conservatives, they're coming together. They're joining forces to come against the Lord Jesus Christ. And note that they ask him to show them a sign from heaven. Now just think about this for a moment. It is quite likely that some of those very people who are demanding a sign from heaven, a sign from our Lord, had personally witnessed some of the things that he'd already been doing. It's quite likely. We know that none of the Jewish leadership ever denied the things that our Lord did. They couldn't. It happened to real people in real time, right in front of them. So rather than acknowledge that Jesus was doing the things that only God could do and make the connection that Jesus must then be the prophesied Messiah, as in see the signs, what did they do? They said that the things our Lord was doing was through the power of Satan, back in chapter 12. Remember? Couldn't be God. Couldn't be the Messiah. Had to be Satan. So these leaders, they had witnessed our Lord's miracles. They had seen many signs and wonders that he had done that only God could do. But they simply refused to believe and demanded a greater sign. The Greek verb that we translate here as test in this verse expects a negative answer. It expects failure. Look what theologian Leon Morris notes. He says the two groups came testing Jesus, where the verb mostly has a bad meaning, testing with a view to failure. It signifies that they were not sincere in their seeking a sign. They evidently thought that Jesus could not produce it, and their intention was not so much actually to see a sign as to show people that Jesus could not produce one. Look at that. I want you to note this and keep it in mind so that you can see what's going on here. The fact that these men were seeking a sign had nothing to do with them wanting to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and just needing a little bit more proof. That's not what it was about. But rather, it had everything to do with wanting to get rid of our Lord and keep things just the way they were in their world. And the sign that they were demanding was something enormous. They wanted something to happen in the heavens, like perhaps the sun stand still, or day become night, or stars fall from the sky. It wasn't enough to see people healed, limbs grown back, and people fed out of nothing, virtually. They wanted to see a sign from heaven. They were demanding something that they didn't think our Lord had the power to do. But even if he had given them the sign that they'd requested, they still would have refused to believe. They would have refused to believe because they had already made up their minds that no matter what happened, they were simply not going to believe that this carpenter's son from the nowhere place of Nazareth could possibly be the Messiah. They had already decided that. They would refuse to believe because they loved their wealth and their power and their social status more than they loved God. It was never about God. It was always about them. Today, when someone demands to see something to prove that there is a God, that person is asking with the same heart as the Pharisees and Sadducees. There's ample proof all around them. Just take a look around. Creation is ample evidence of the existence of a creator. Only a fool says there is no God. Just as in our Lord's day, those today who ask for a sign do so because they love themselves and they love their lifestyle more than anything else, and they're not willing to give that up. Don't you look what Dr. MacArthur notes here. He says, the liberal theologian does not prefer the speculations of philosophy or psychology because they are more provable or persuasive than the truths of Scripture, but because he prefers man's wisdom to God's. And, contrary to his claim, the agnostic does not refuse to believe because he cannot know about God, but because he will not know about him. Powerful words of truth. Let's move on. Take a look at how our Lord answers them in verses 2 and 3 together. He answered them, "When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be stormy today, for the sky is red and threatening. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret
the signs of the times. Surely you've heard the saying, red sky at night is a sailor's delight, red sky in the morning is a sailor's warning, right? I think my grandpa told me that when I was just a little boy, and I still remember it today. Every time I see a red sky, I think about that saying. And apparently it was a means of forecasting the weather back in our Lord's day as well. This is a verbal slam from our Lord. He's telling the very group of people who are supposed to be the experts in Scripture that they're really better meteorologists than they are theologians. That's what he's telling them. They're better at determining whether or not it's going to rain than they are at interpreting the signs that the Scriptures say identify the Messiah. A slam. They're better at interpreting the things of the world than the things of God. They will not see the Messiah because they refuse to see the Messiah even though he is standing right in front of them. They refuse to see him. Now verse 4. An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of Jonah. So he left them and departed. Our Lord identifies those who are seeking for a sign as evil and adulterous. It's evil because it's turned away from goodness and what is right to seek and serve what is evil and what is wrong. It's adulterous because it's a generation of people who are supposed to belong to God. They're supposed to be in a covenant relationship with God, just like you're in a covenant relationship in a marriage, but instead they've taken up company with the devil. They're cheating. They're committing adultery. They've rejected the vows they made to God to be joined with the evil one. It is this type of generation, a generation that has forsaken God and his word, that seeks after a sign. Do you see that? Does that sound familiar to you? Right now, here in America and around the world for that matter, people by the millions are calling things that are evil good and things that are good evil. Just turn on the news. They have rejected the love of God for the love of the world. It was an adulterous and evil generation in our Lord's day, and it's still one today. It's still one today. So our Lord tells them that they're not going to receive a sign for him other than the sign of Jonah. And he leaves it at that. He doesn't explain it to them. He doesn't explain what the sign of Jonah would be, as he did back in chapter 12. If you remember back there, he went into great detail of what that was. He just leaves it at that this time. The sign of Jonah is that just as Jonah was literally 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so too would our Lord be 3 days and three nights in the grave. And just as Jonah was delivered from the belly of the great fish, alive and well, so too will the Lord Jesus Christ rise from the grave, alive and well, defeating death in the grave forevermore for all those who will repent and believe in him. That's the sign of Jonah. That's the greatest sign of all, is it not? Yet even when that happened, in front of them, as we know that it did, these very men who were questioning our Lord still refused to believe. Even after seeing the sign of Jonah, they still refused to believe. And we know that to be the case because we're told in Matthew 28 that the Jewish leaders bribed the soldiers to say that the body was stolen. They refused to believe. They knew that Jesus rose from the dead, but they still refused to believe it. Because it was never about proving the truth, but rather about rejecting the truth. It wasn't about proving it, it was about rejecting it. And note the last sentence in this verse. So he left them and departed. So he left them and departed. What did our Lord do? He left them. He got back in the boat and departed for the north shore of the Sea of Galilee. So we'll see next week. But the Greek word that's translated as left here in the English carries overtones of forsaking or abandoning. The Jewish leaders rejected our Lord, so he left them to their sin. He left them. And this marks an important point in our Lord's ministry. We'll have to watch for this. From this point forward, our Lord spent the vast majority of his time with his disciples and very little time with the crowds and non-believers. He turns away from those who reject him and focuses or turns towards those who belong to him. So what can we glean from our short passage today? There's two things that I want us to note. First, you do not need a sign. You don't need a sign. Look what Dr. R.C. Sproul notes. He says, people may want more from God, but they are not going to get it. He already has given enough evidence to make every human being culpable to him by raising Jesus from the dead. Thus, all people everywhere are already under divine obligation to come to Jesus. And note this, coming to him is not an option. It is a requirement that God himself has laid upon the world. It's not an option. You don't need a sign. If you're seeking a sign, please take one of the Bibles from back on the welcome table with you when you go. That's the only sign that you need. You can't see the sign because you haven't read the sign if you're seeking for a sign. If you want to hear from God, then read his word. If you want to hear from him audibly, read it out loud. You don't need a sign. When you repent and trust in Christ, all the answers you need are found in the pages of Scripture, and that is all the sign that you need. They're right there. You don't need some self-professed prophet to give you a word of knowledge or prophesy over you. All you need to do is read the Word of God. And secondly, if you persist in your sins long enough, rejecting and refusing the Lord Jesus Christ as the Jewish leadership did, as we just saw, there will come a day when either your heart will be hardened and you'll not be able to repent and trust in him, or you will die in that state. And either way, the results are the same. Hellfire. Hellfire. So I beg you not to delay. Don't put it off. Today is the day of salvation, and now is the accepted time. I beg you to repent and believe on the Lord Jesus today, right now, and you'll be saved. Don't delay. Amen. Today is the first Sunday of the month, so I'd ask the ushers to come forward, please. We're going to come to the Lord's table together today. Brothers and sisters, as we draw near to the Lord's table to celebrate the communion of the body and the blood of Christ, we're grateful to remember that our Lord instituted this ordinance, note, not to have any saving power, but rather for the perpetual memory of his dying for our sakes and the pledge of his undying love. He instituted it as a reminder of a bond of our union with him and our bond with each other as members of this body, of his body. He did so as a seal of his grace to us and a renewal of our obedience to him. We should be reminded of our need for obedience. He did so for the blessed assurance of his presence with us who are gathered here today, this morning, in his name. He did so as an opportunity for us who love the Savior to feed spiritually on him who is the bread of life, and as a pledge of his coming again. He's coming again. The sacred time at the Lord's table is for the believer, for those who have rested all their hope on the death and resurrection of Christ, If you are not yet a believer, then you should refrain from partaking in the Lord's table until such a time as you come to faith through repentance and faith. Then you may joyfully come to the Lord's table along with the rest of the body of Christ. I encourage those of you who are believers to examine your hearts. Examine your hearts. Make sure that you're coming to the Lord's table in a worthy manner. Make sure that you're not harboring any unforgiveness towards anyone. Make sure that you don't have any unconfessed sin in your life. If you're struggling with either of those issues, then please refrain from the Lord's table until such a time as your heart is right. You need to make sure that you have a correct balance of grace and obedience. You need to understand that there's nothing that you could have done that's too bad for you to be forgiven. All you need to do is cry out to God in repentance and faith. I want you to remember that there's nothing that you could have done in your life that the sacrifice that Christ paid some 2,000 years ago with his blood won't cover. There's no sins that the blood of the God-man won't cover. God loved you enough to sacrifice his son so that you might have eternal life. Simply repent of your sins and cling to Christ and the cross for salvation. If you're claiming to be a Christian, examine your heart and see if your life reflects that claim. Are you living a righteous life, anxiously awaiting the return of the Lord? If not, I want to encourage you to get it lined out before it's too late. I want you to remember the sacrifice that was given for you. And think about the very real and very near future return of the Lord Jesus. You see, in 100 years, we're all going to be there. Whether he's back or not, everybody in this room will be there in 100 years. You'll be standing before him. So make sure that your heart is right before you come to the Lord's table. On the night of his betrayal, the Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he also took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant established by my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we are thankful for the opportunity to come to your table, to reflect on your great sacrifice, to reflect on your great love for us. God, it's hard to imagine sometimes the sacrifice that was given for us. We don't understand it. We take it for granted that God became a man and stood in our place and took our sins upon himself and died to save us from God. God came to save us from God. Lord, help us understand that. And Father, if there are those here today who don't know you, Lord, as always, we pray for them and ask that you would save them, Lord. Draw them to yourself. And Father, as we go about our week, Lord, help us to reflect on this text, that to dig into your word, to not seek after signs, to trust in you, to be a light Lord, to be ambassadors for the Lord Jesus Christ, that others might see you in us. Help us to love you more. Help us to love each other more. We ask that you forgive us of our sins, that you grant us repentance and increase our faith. And we ask all this for your glory. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Y'all have a great week, and we'll see you next week.